Hi guys, welcome back to Apocalypse. I'm going to be sticking with the theme of missing islands of the Atlantic for this episode, so today I'm going to be talking about a phantom island located a day's sail west of Ireland, a magical place that has spawned numerous myths and legends over the centuries. But could there be more to this island than just fairy tales? Is there a geological explanation for its disappearance? Or could it simply be a myth derived from earlier Indo-European traditions? Perhaps there is some truth to the story of High Brazil. High Brazil. This mythical island is a topic that has been talked about for centuries. Even to this day it continues to fascinate people with the multitude of myths and legends surrounding it. Scholars, historians, sailors and adventurers have searched for this mystical island, but none have found it. Despite the similarities in their names, it has no direct association with the South American country of Brazil. Instead, if we look at the etymology of High Brazil, we can see that the most likely explanation for its name derives from the Irish I Briseil, which translates to descendants of Clan Briseil. Clan Briseil was one of the ancient clans formerly located in northeastern Ireland. High Brazil has shown up on numerous maps and charts over the centuries, turning up as early as 1330, as seen in Angelino Dulcert's Portolan chart. Here, the island is inscribed in Latin with the title of Insula de Montanis Sul do Brasil. This translates to Isle of Sheep or of Brazil. Virtually nothing is known about Angelino Dulcert, so it's impossible to say where he got his source material from with regards to the mythical lost island. Subsequent to Dulcert's chart, we can see High Brazil located in various similar locations on many other maps, charts, and atlases, including the 1375 Catalan Atlas, this 1513 map from Piri Reis, a map of Europe from 1570, Abraham Ortelius's map of Europe from 1595, and this map from Gerardus Mercator, also dated to 1595. This list, however, is far from exhaustive. In the 1480s and 1490s, a number of expeditions were launched from the port of Bristol in an attempt to locate the lost island. Local merchants believed that Bristol mariners had located High Brazil at an earlier date, but somehow went on to lose track of the sizeable landmass. Now, to me, this sounds like these mariners may well have seen a mirage or similar refractive phenomena on the horizon. Upon consulting their navigational charts, they may well have conflated this mirage with the island of High Brazil. I would speculate that both the merchants and mariners understood the possibility that this sighting could simply have been nothing more than a mirage, but there was still a significant economic incentive to launch multiple expeditions in an attempt to relocate this phantom island. By what seems to be nothing more than word association, it was believed by many that High Brazil could have been a rich source of Brazil wood, better known today as sapan wood. This precious tree was in great demand as it could be used to produce a valuable reddish dye called Brazilin. This dye was used not only to colour fabrics, it was also used to make red paints and inks. Typically, sapan wood could only be located in tropical parts of Asia, so it was understandable why the risk was taken to launch so many expeditions in an attempt to exploit and profit from the valuable resources of the mythical island. Just on a quick tangent, before we move on, the reason why the sapan wood tree today is no longer known as Brazil wood is because its South American cousin, the Pau Brasilia tree, had usurped this title from its Asian counterpart. Portuguese explorers realised that the South American species bared such strong similarities to the Old World variety that they named it Pau Brasil. Pau Brasil was in such abundance in coastal South America that it began to dominate the market for red dye. This dominance led to the Pau Brasil tree inheriting the title of Brazilwood. The abundance of this tree along coastal South America is the very reason why the country of Brazil is so named. Terra do Brasil, or Land of Brazilwood, was simply shortened to Brazil. So, are there any plausible geological explanations that might explain a missing landmass off the coast of Ireland? At first glance, it would appear not. If we take a look at the modern bathymetric data for the region, the closest feature that is still partially above water today is the Rockall Bank, but it's simply too far away from the coast of Ireland to be High Brazil. Similarly, the Anton Dorn and Hebrides Terrace seamounts are also both too far away, not to mention too deep to be viable candidates. If we strictly stick to the locations marked in earlier navigational charts, we can see that there really is nothing there that could have been above the surface of the ocean, even at the peak of the last glacial maximum, circa 20,000 years ago, when sea levels were up to 140 meters lower than they are today. As far as the existing geology is concerned, there really is no visible evidence for a missing island off the west coast of Ireland. However, when you start to understand the nature and sheer abundance of the cold water corals found in the region of the Porcupine Bank, you will soon see that there is a plausible biological mechanism that might explain how an island could have been created over hundreds of thousands of years before its subsequent destruction in more recent times. Located approximately 200 kilometers or 120 miles west of Ireland, the Porcupine Bank was discovered in 1862 by the survey vessel HMS Porcupine. The Porcupine Bank is classified as a shoal, meaning that the submerged bank is covered with unconsolidated material. On January the 20th of 1870, less than a decade after the discovery of the Porcupine Bank, a Mr. W. Fraser presented a paper to the Geological Society of Ireland, where he suggested that the Porcupine Bank might be the sunken remains of High Brazil. Over the years, numerous other researchers have also gone on to make similar suggestions. Initially, when you look at the data for the Porcupine Bank, it would seem that its peak, at a depth of 200 meters below sea level, is far too deep to have been above water for many millions of years. But after spending some time studying the Porcupine Bank, I think I found a viable mechanism that might explain how an island could emerge, then subsequently disappear in a relatively short span of time. The Porcupine Bank is famous for its cold water corals. These are some of the most pristine and unspoiled cold water corals on the entire planet. Experts and academics travel from all over the world to study these spectacular specimens. The Porcupine Bank sits on the edge of the Porcupine Sea Bight, a deep water oceanic basin located on the continental margin in the northeastern portion of the Atlantic Ocean. The Porcupine Sea Bight is home to more than 1,000 carbonate mounds. These carbonate mounds are formed from the accumulation of cold water corals that trap fine-grained sediment. As the coral dies, the skeleton remains behind, along with the trapped sediment. New coral continues to grow on top of the dead coral. Given enough time, a mound is formed. Some carbonate mounds have been known to reach heights of up to 600 meters. Now, the reason why you only see these mounds in the basin of the Porcupine Sea Bight and not on the adjacent shoal of the Porcupine Bank is because the water at these relatively shallow depths is simply too warm to accommodate these cold water corals. At 53 degrees north, the Porcupine Bank sits at a relatively high latitude. This latitude suggests that the surface waters here should be much colder than they actually are. However, the warm water driven northeastwards by the Gulf Stream keeps these waters relatively warm, although you'll still need a wetsuit at a minimum if you ever want to go scuba diving off the coast of Ireland. Although presently warm, you'll find that the shallow waters surrounding coastal Ireland weren't always as warm as they are today. The last 2.58 million years of the Quaternary represent a period of oscillating temperatures characterized by glacial and interglacial intervals. If we take a look at temperature records derived from ice core samples taken at Vostok, Antarctica, you'll see that global average temperatures oscillate widely over spans of about 100,000 years or so. It was during these glacial periods that much of northwestern Europe, including Ireland, was covered in ice. The shallow waters surrounding Ireland were also much cooler than they are today. I believe there's a reasonable possibility During these glacial periods that cold water corals could start to take hold on the shallow shoals of the Porcupine Bank. The observant among you will be pointing out that glacial sea levels were much shallower than our current interglacial sea levels, as much as 140 meters lower. Hence, there's no possible way that this mechanism could produce an island that would break through the surface of present-day coastal Ireland. This is absolutely correct, but I would suggest that this mound-building process takes place in two steps. The first step, as I just described, takes place during the glacial periods, when sea levels are lower. The second step, however, takes place immediately after interglacial warming comes to an end. You see, over the last 420,000 years, and possibly for most of the last 2.58 million years, interglacial warming comes to an abrupt end when a sufficient volume of meltwater has been able to dilute and therefore disrupt the thermohaline circulation patterns of the world's oceans. This means that warmth from the tropics can no longer be transferred to higher and lower latitudes using mechanisms such as the Gulf Stream, for example. As average global temperatures decline, the corresponding drop in sea level takes thousands of years. If we use sea levels from the Eemian Interglacial as an example, where sea levels were a maximum of 8 to 10 meters higher than they are today, we find that there is a window of approximately 10,000 years where cold water corals could establish themselves at above present day sea levels. Even if 10,000 years isn't enough for this process to take place, please bear in mind that there have been repeated glacials and interglacials over the course of the Quaternary for the last 2.58 million years, so this isn't a one-off event. Okay, so we have a possible mechanism for the formation of an island in the region of the Porcupine Bank. But how might it disappear? Well, it could be a case of high stand shedding followed by wave cutting. High stand simply means when sea levels are close to their interglacial maximum, as we are today. During a high stand period, a depositional system can lose most of its sediment to the adjacent basin. Essentially, for our scenario, the sediment is washed out of the coral matrix, leaving behind a much more porous structure. This structure is then more susceptible to wave cutting. Given enough time, the wave action will create a level platform. Stormy weather will give the sea enough energy to create a lower wave base, so this platform typically sits a few tens of meters below sea level. If High Brazil ever did exist, this process might explain some of its disappearance, but it isn't enough to explain the total disappearance of an island that was at its base 200 meters below sea level. If we look at the abundance of submarine canyons surrounding the Porcupine Bank, we can see evidence for a geological process called slumping. Submarine canyons are typically formed over long spans of time by turbidity currents. These are rapidly moving, sediment-laden, underwater currents that move down a slope. Slumping occurs when too much sediment has accumulated at the top of a continental slope, particularly at the head of a submarine canyon. This overload causes the sediment to slump and slide down the slope or canyon, creating turbidity currents as a consequence. Once the slumping process has been initiated, it will last until the load has been sufficiently depleted. Although slumping usually occurs when a critical mass of sediment has accumulated at the top of a slope or canyon, it can be triggered early by seismic activity. Perhaps if High Brazil were a carbonate mound, it might have been consumed by multiple slumping events in one or more of the submarine canyons surrounding the Porcupine Bank. After all, large quantities of coral rubble can be found at the bottom of these canyons. There is, however, one big flaw with my proposed process for the biological creation of High Brazil. Cold water corals are typically only found at depths greater than 50 meters below the surface. Given that sea levels during the Eemian were only a maximum of 10 meters higher than they are today, the summit of this carbonate mound would still have been 40 meters below present-day sea levels. I still think this is an idea worthy of further investigation, but perhaps we should be looking elsewhere to explain High Brazil. Maybe it's time that we turned to mythology. The idea of a sunken island in the ocean that lay to the west is a concept that is far from unique in northern Celtic traditions. The Bretons of northwestern France, the Cornish in southwest England, the Welsh and even the Scottish all have one or more of their own myths regarding a mystical sunken island. There are a couple that really stand out. The first is the lost Welsh island of Annwn. The name translates to very deep, but likely has an older translation meaning underworld. The second is another lost Irish island, Tiernanog, or the Land of the Young. Tiernanog represents the Celtic Otherworld, a supernatural realm, an island paradise of eternal youth, abundance and joy, complete with its own pantheon of gods. Tiernanog is often conflated with High Brazil. After all, they may very well share a similar mythological origin. Prehistoric Ireland shares a similar demographic story to prehistoric Great Britain. A human presence in Ireland can be traced to as far back as 33,000 years ago, but between about 24 and 18,000 years ago, Ireland would have been uninhabitable as it was covered with ice more than 3 kilometres or nearly 2 miles thick for the duration of the last glacial maximum. This ice sheet extended beyond the southern coast of Ireland. At around 12,500 years ago, a human presence returned to Ireland as the land became increasingly hospitable. But it wasn't until about 10,000 years ago, when the Ice Age completely came to an end in Ireland, that people started to become permanent settlers. These people were seafarers, their livelihood depended upon the ocean, so their settlements were usually close to the water. I'm finding it difficult to find out much about these early settlers, but it would seem to me that these people predated any of the Proto-Indo-European belief systems that were only beginning to emerge thousands of kilometres to the east. I would speculate that their culture and religious practices might have revolved around nature or animism. Perhaps many of their traditions revolved around the sea. Around about 6,000 years ago, more settlers began to arrive in Ireland. They brought with them their Neolithic technology, agricultural practices, and their culture, rooted in Proto-Indo-European belief systems. It was during this Neolithic period that the majority of Ireland's megalithic structures were built. 4,500 years ago, the Belbeca culture arrived in Ireland. With their Bronze Age technology, they soon became the dominant people in the land. 2,500 years ago, the Celtic peoples began to settle in Ireland, bringing with them their Iron Age technology. Once again, like the Neolithic settlers, they had a belief system rooted in Proto-Indo-European mythology. With each wave of immigration into Ireland, the previous settlers were never completely eradicated. Much of the culture of the Belbeca people still remains an enigma, but we can say that both the Neolithic and Celtic settlers had belief systems with similar Proto-Indo-European origins. And just like the ancient Egyptians, the pre-Christian Irish believed that the souls of the dead departed westwards over the sea with the setting sun to find the land of the dead, the underworld, or the otherworld. Perhaps High Brazil and Tiernanog are nothing more than myths inspired by Proto-Indo-European traditions that originated thousands of kilometres away. By having these lost islands closer to home, it would have made their belief system more relevant to their culture. Perhaps there was even some influence from the original seafaring settlers of Ireland. Legacy stories handed down from their most ancient ancestors blended into their Celtic traditions. So what can we conclude about High Brazil? Well, we know from modern bathymetric data that there is presently no trace of an intact island below the surface of the waters west of Ireland. But we have established that there might be a plausible, if somewhat flawed, biological and geological mechanism for its creation and subsequent destruction. On the other hand, it certainly seems as if the Lost Island fit in very well with the belief systems of the pre-Christian inhabitants of Ireland. Have we come any closer to solving the mystery of High Brazil, or have we just muddied the waters even further? Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Is there any geological truth to this lost island, or is it just a myth derived from earlier traditions? I really hope that you enjoyed this video and that it piqued your curiosity. If you did like it, please give this video a thumbs up, hit the subscribe button and the bell icon down below. I'll have more interesting videos for you soon. Cheers.